good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us in this beautiful day. It's definitely church weather this time of year, so it's beautiful. We're getting ready for spring. We're still preparing ourselves for Easter. And we have this very interesting lesson right in the middle of Lent. And a lot of people love this passage for all the wrong reasons. And then it's easy to love the passage. It's impassioned. Jesus is not the stagnant teacher that goes around and is all wise. Jesus gets mad. He overturns the tables. He drives out the moneylenders and all of these dealers with a whip of cords that he made. It's really dramatic. And for us, in our perspective, it's easy to say, yes, those people were terrible sinners. Those people were defiling the house of God. For bringing in all of these stalls and whatnot. But really, they were empowering people to worship in the way that they were requested. Making sacrifices at the temple was part of the religious life of Jewish people in Jesus' day. This was just as normal to them as it is for us doing a pledge campaign or asking you all for money for the nursery that we're building downstairs, which I will do later on in the service. It's normal. It's necessary. Maybe a little bit uncomfortable, but we live with that uncomfortable element just because stuff needs to get done. And it was necessary in Jesus' day because people would travel for days, for weeks, even months, to get and do their sacrifice at the temple. And you can't really carry doves with you when you're on that journey. It's hard to carry cattle with you. It's impractical. So, as the free market dictates, there was a demand for money changers and for people selling cattle and doves in the temple, and people provided it so that they could worship in the way that they were called. This was a well-established practice. No one considered it sinful, and Jesus drove them all out. And it's easy for us to see why Jesus did that. But for them, it would have been extremely controversial. It would have been unsettling and uncomfortable, and we are just as guilty of sin as those people were. The lesson hidden within the gospel, hidden in plain sight, is that sin is all around us. That there are institutions that we rely on, that we consider to be very necessary, that are fundamentally sinful at the core. It doesn't point to that truth, that Jesus Christ died for our sins, that God loves all of humanity and not just us, that we are no more leaders of the world over other people than anyone else is. And then we can see this happen throughout history. If you read theology written in the 19th century, there were a lot of Anglican and Episcopal theologians that railed against slavery, and there was just as many that supported it. And it wasn't just that slavery was necessary in their eyes. It was a virtuous institution, for they were so blinded by their own sin that they thought their sin was a virtue. And we see this time and time again. And then when we are here, comfortable and in the present, we can look at the past and say, I can't believe they thought that. I can't believe they believed that. But we are just as guilty of so many more sins that we are completely unaware of. There are institutions that we participate in every day, and then just by the nature of the sin, we can't see it, just as the theologians of the 19th century could not see slavery for what it is, just as the money changers and the people selling cattle in God's temple could not see that what they were doing was sacrilege. This is a harsh reality. And then sometimes we even go a step further. And then we look at injustice in our day, and we think that we have the perfect prescription for it. And then let's say there's a controversy within this church. I know that would never happen. But it will, and that's fine. Half of the congregation may be utterly convinced that they know the way forward, and that the people on the other side are completely sinful, that they are blinded by their own sin. They might even look at this passage and say, we need to be like Jesus. We need to drive out these money changers and these sinners. Let's say they fail. Then probably what they'll do is they'll leave the church in a big self-righteous huff, and they'll go off and start their own church, and then everyone loses. Because then the controversy stops. Sometimes we avoid controversy like the plague, but really it's something we should embrace. Or we want to keep controversy out of the church, but this is exactly where we should embrace it. Because controversy is the heartbeat of our organization. It means that people are invested. And this can be a place where we can disagree with each other with compassion and with grace. This is where the conversation can happen. And if we read this passage and we want to be Jesus and we want to drive out sin from this institution, then there will be no one left but ourselves at the end of the day. That we will be trapped in our own little bubble. And the Episcopal Church has known controversies, especially in the last 50 years. The first major controversy was with the new prayer book, and the fact that we're calling it the new prayer book still baffles me. The new prayer book was commissioned in 1979, and then immediately people started to form little organizations called the Prayer Book Society, where they saw everything about the new prayer book as just being absolutely terrible. And then so they broke off in a big huff. They formed their own little churches, and they continue to worship in the 1928 prayer book, and they're still doing it. And then shortly thereafter, we started to ordain women. And then this was voted on by the Episcopal Church. We started to do that. Now, it feels pretty normal. I've never known an Episcopal Church that did not ordain women. But this was a huge controversy. When the first women were ordained to the priesthood, people had razors in their hands. When they come to take communion, they try to slash their hands in protest. And those people left. They could not be part of a church that would ordain women. And then in 2003, Gene Robinson, an openly gay man, was ordained bishop in New Hampshire. And then immediately people started leaving again. They left off in a big huff, and the church is becoming smaller and smaller and smaller. It embraces less and less perspectives. And I went to seminary in a remarkable time where we just got fed up with talking about this incessantly. Like, yeah, let's talk about it, but let's not put this over Christology or the doctrine of the Trinity and all of these amazing things we want to learn as well. And then controversy will always be within the church. And sometimes we can push people out, or we can leave ourselves where it limits the conversation. And when that happens, when we think that we can be like Jesus in that way, we all lose. And then the church has become significantly more liberal in the decades past, but I mourn the loss of the conservative brothers and sisters that decided to leave, that decided that the Episcopal Church was not for them. We are less whole. And then for me, it was easy being part of the Episcopal Church as it is today, but it's not easy for everyone. And when I was in seminary, and my seminary was surprisingly diverse. There was about equal parts liberal and conservative. But there was one individual named Daniel that stuck out, and he was so conservative that he made the conservatives look liberal. He was that sort of guy. And he and I spent a lot of time together. He was 2 years ahead of me, and we were both interested in sports, and I got to know him well. And he was actually actively courted by all of these breakaway churches. And then he was incredibly talented. He was a great preacher. He was very compassionate. And then say, come join us. And if I were in his shoes, I'd be tempted to do that as well. In such a small organization, that's very well funded. He could easily climb the ladder. He would be a bishop in no time. He would be a star player in that breakaway church in just a few years. And then his sending diocese actually refused to ordain him because of his views. And he had to find a different diocese his last year in seminary. It was a great injustice. And he was committed to staying with the Episcopal Church. He was committed to staying even though sometimes he felt like he was being pushed out. He was committed to staying even though sometimes he was tempted to leave so he could be in his own little bubble. And he was committed to staying because he felt like he had something to contribute. And that he had something to learn. He figured out what so few of us have figured out. It's not always about having your side win. It's not always about being right. Sometimes it's more about being in community. It's about being committed to the conversation. And out of all of these controversies and all of these pains that we have experienced as a church, he's the real hero in all of this. It's easy to stay when your side wins. It's so hard to stay when you feel like you're being pushed out. We have something to learn from him as well. We are not called to be as strong and as perfectly oriented as Jesus is in this passage. We are not called to make our cord of whips and drive each other out. Jesus wasn't excluding them from the love of God and from that community. He was trying to show them that he was the way, that he was the temple. This very communion that we are going to celebrate today was the temple that was built back up in 3 days. And this is what binds us together, this celebration of that grace and of that mercy, of that miracle, of that saving grace. And when we stray from that truth, then we feel empowered to leave in a huff because everyone else is wrong except for me. Or we feel called to drive out the sinners in our midst. But when we do that, we lose. And we forget that we are here because